Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Welcome to today's lecture. We are going to talk about DNA tools and gene cloning. So, in the previous lecture, you have learnt about the theoretical concepts of DNA cloning. Today, you will get familiar with the various steps which are involved in performing DNA cloning in a laboratory setup. You will also see that how a gene of interest is inserted in a vector, then it is selected based on the presence of an antibiotic gene. So, let us start the lab demonstration session now.
Hello everybody, today we are going to discuss about the workflow of molecular cloning. Molecular cloning has some basic steps which we are going to go one by one. So, firstly, what we are trying to do is introduce a foreign gene into an organism which we normally refer to as insert. So, this is my insert sample. So, what we do is we take our insert DNA, we introduce it into a carrier molecule normally known as vector. So, most commonly used vectors include plasmids. So, in this case, we are using a plasmid DNA in which we are going to introduce a foreign gene, our insert. So, there are, as you may know, plasmids, they occur naturally in bacteria, and over the years studies have been done and we have seen that these plasmids also have some antibiotic resistance gene. So, which confers a resistance against a particular antibiotic to the bacteria. So, if a bacteria is grown under that antibiotic conditions, its growth will not be affected and it will grow perfectly normal. So, here we have our vector DNA, we have our insert. So, in order to introduce my insert into the vector, so let's begin with the experiment. We have taken our vector DNA. Also, we have our insert DNA. What we are going to do is, we are going to treat them with restriction enzymes. Restriction enzymes are going to cut these DNA and they will create compatible ends so that the insert and the vector, they can join and form a perfectly circular structure. So, we are going to carry out restriction digestion separately for insert and vector. So, what we need to do is, first we take our vector. Then we add the restriction enzyme buffer, which is needed by the enzyme to carry out the digestion. We also add water to make up the volume. And the last step, we add the enzyme. So, enzyme usually is added in a very small quantity. So, I'll use a different pipette for that. So, in this case, we are using EcoR1 enzyme. So, throughout the process, we need to make sure that it's carried out using aseptic conditions. So, the tips should be autoclaved, the tubes also should be sterile. At the same time, we should carry out the entire reaction on ice. So, right now, I have made the cocktail, restriction digestion cocktail for the vector. I'm going to do the same thing for the insert, and then we will keep the tubes at 37 degree, which is the optimum temperature for the enzymes to act. So right now I am carrying out restriction digestion for the insert. So this is the insert. I'm going to add the restriction buffer. So I'm adding different volumes for each of the components, and accordingly I'm adjusting the pipette as well. Now I am adding water. So the last thing is the enzyme. So I'm going to vortex the tube so that the components are mixed properly. Then I'm going to give them a short spin so that whatever has stuck to the walls will come down. Now we will incubate the tubes at 37 degree for 1 hour. Now we will incubate the tubes at 37 degree. So the incubation will be done for 1 hour. So after restriction digestion has been performed, the next step is ligation of the two DNAs. So we have our vector DNA as well as the insert DNA, which has been cleaved by the restriction enzyme. So now we'll join the two compatible ends using the ligase enzyme. So here we have all the components of the reaction. First we'll take our DNA, vector DNA. Then we will add the insert. So once we've added vector as well as insert, we'll add ligation buffer. So before adding anything, so we just need to pipette it a little, we need to mix it a little bit. So this is the ligation buffer. I'll give it a small vortex. I will add this to the ligation mix. Now the last thing to be added is the ligase enzyme. Again, we are using a small pipette because we require very little quantity of the enzyme. I'll give it a short vortex again to the enzyme. Now our ligation mix is ready. We will vortex it a little. Followed by a short spin. Now we will incubate this at room temperature for 3 hours. After ligation is done, the next step is transformation. So, after ligation, the vector and the insert, they form a covalently closed structure, and this DNA molecule, the combined DNA molecule, will be introduced into a host cell. So, in this case, we have taken a DH5-alpha host cell, which does not have any restriction enzyme which will chop off any foreign DNA. So, we will introduce our DNA into this host cell so that it can propagate further. So, this step transformation is carried out inside a laminar hood under sterile conditions. So, inside the hood we have sterile filters which make keep the inside air clean. So, before we start with the experiment, first we switch on the UV for 10 minutes. This step ensures that inside the conditions are extremely sterile. This step ensures that inside the laminar hood conditions are extremely sterile and are good for our work. So after this, we'll switch off the UV and we'll switch on the fan and the light button. Now we'll carry out the transformation experiment. So we have our ligated sample. We'll also keep a negative control water. So in all the experiments, we normally keep a negative control. So, we have our competent cells, which are the host cells in which we will introduce our recombinant molecule. In one of the tubes, we'll add our recombinant molecule. In the other tube, we'll add our negative control water. This is our ligation mix, which we will add in the competent cells. So now we will incubate the tubes on ice for 30 minutes. Now we will give the samples heat shock treatment. So we'll keep the tubes at 42 degrees Celsius for 2 minutes. this heat shock treatment helps the host cell to get the foreign DNA. This heat shock treatment helps the foreign DNA to get introduced inside the host cell. So now we will perform the plating. So as you can see, we already have plates, LB agar plates. These plates, they have a lot of components which will help the bacteria to grow. Additionally, we have added the antibiotic ampicillin. Because our vector, the plasmid DNA, has ampicillin resistant gene. So that when we will plate our ligated product onto this, only those colonies will show up which have our vector. So for one plate, I'll be using the ligated sample which has been transformed into the DH5-alpha host cell. For the other plate, I'll use for the negative control, which has been given the same treatment as our ligated product. So I will take the sample. So I will add the sample in drops. So this is the spreader which I am going to use for plating. So the spreader is already dipped in ethanol so that all the microorganisms, if any, will get killed. So I'll put it to flame so that the alcohol evaporates. I'll wait for the spreader's temperature to get down, because if it is too hot, it may kill my DNA sample as well. I can touch it here so that it becomes cool. Now I'll start plating. So I'll be doing the plating in circular motions so that the sample is spreaded uniformly. I'll do it till a point where I feel that the entire sample is spread uniformly, and when the agar seems to look a little dry and there is some friction, at that point I'll stop. One needs to ensure that we do not press it too hard, else we may end up breaking the agar plate as well. I'll show the lid some flame and I'll keep it back. I'll label my plate. Next, I will plate the negative control sample, which is nothing but water. So normally we keep the plates this way upside down. Otherwise, if we keep them like this, they sometimes, because of the loose ends, we may end up having some sort of contamination. So usually we keep upside down. Right now I've done plating, so for some time I'll keep it like this, the straight way. Later I'll keep it upside down as well. Now I'll take the negative control sample. Again, I'll add in the form of little drops, spread it uniformly. I'll show my spreader flame. I'll wait for a few seconds for the spreader's temperature to come down. This is how my plate looks like. Now I have started feeling some friction on the plate, so if I poke it further, it may break. So at this point, I'll stop. Now I'll take my plates and I'll keep them in the incubator. So these are the plates which I'll keep in the incubator for overnight incubation. So as you can see, the temperature ranges from 37 to 38, which is ideal for the bacteria to grow. I can show you another plate, which we have already done transformation yesterday, and how a transformed plate looks like. So this is a transformed plate which has a lot of colonies inside. So in this case, the transformation efficiency has been very good. In some cases, we do not get as many colonies. So right now we have kept two plates. In one, we hope that we have a good transformation efficiency. And in the second plate, we should expect it to be blank, because that is just water, to ensure that our experiments are absolutely fine and there is no contamination. So once we obtain the colonies, we need to be sure whether these colonies reflect our true recombinant molecule. Because as you know, once we have done restriction digestion, we can get different kinds of products. It may happen that during ligation, the vector itself ligates and have a self-ligated molecule. Or it may happen that there is only the insert that has transformed into the host cell. So we need to be sure whether these colonies actually have are the recombinant molecule. So one thing we are sure that there is no insert here, because the vector has antibiotic resistance gene. And here, in the media, we have our antibiotic ampicillin. So only those colonies which have the vector will grow on these. Now those colonies can be the self-ligated vector, or they can be the recombinant molecule having the insert. For that, we'll take these colonies. We'll grow them, we'll isolate the plasmid, and we'll check their size. So this is an LB media. This is the same media which has been, which is already, in the solidified form in this agar plate. So this LB media has all the components which is required by the bacteria to grow. So we'll pick up a colony, we'll add it in this LB media. We'll also add our antibiotic, the antibiotic for which the resistant gene is already present on the vector, so that only our vector grows, no other contamination is seen. So we will first add the antibiotic. This is our antibiotic ampicillin. Everything we are doing near the flame, so that there is no contamination, there is no chance of any contamination. Now I will pick up a colony. This again we will incubate at 37 for overnight, almost 16 hours. So this is the shaking incubator in which I'll keep this tube for overnight incubation. So you can see the temperature set is 37, which is ideal for the bacterial growth. So this is how a bacteria culture looks like. You can see it is very turbid. And after, this is a sign that the bacteria has grown properly overnight. So this is a tube which we have just kept for the overnight incubation. You can see the color of this tube. It's not so turbid, it is transparent. But after the growth, this is how it looks like.
So in conclusions, I hope now your concept for the gene cloning is much better and much clearer now. As you've just seen the lab demonstration session, with the advent of technological advancements, the genetic engineering can be performed in a laboratory setup with great ease now. While it might look straightforward, but the cloning a gene often involves lot of thought process, and the whole parameter optimization may take several months time to really obtain the correct clone, and then you have to ensure that the sequence is correct and it is not self-ligated vector. What you have obtained is the right gene of interest which you started with. So, of course, the process looks straightforward and much simpler, but to actually obtain a right clone in frame does need good standard operating protocols and sometime a good experience of knowing the concepts involved in genetic engineering. So I hope you enjoyed the lab session, and we'll continue our interactions and discussion about gene cloning in the next lecture as well. Thank you.